Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Well, first of all, thank you very much for those thoughtful and important remarks. I think in reading your book, Shows About Nothing, you attempt to address, you address very well the crises of nihilism in popular culture. And what I want to start off, one, is by looking at the problem of nihilism, which is a human problem. And I'd like to quote and then ask some of your reflections on this from, are you familiar with Nishitani Meiji? Have you read anything by him?
No.
Okay. He wrote a book called Overcoming Nihilism. It's actually really worth reading. But anyway, he says, on the one hand, nihilism is a problem that transcends time and space and is rooted in the essence of human being, an existential problem in which the being of the self is revealed to the self itself as something groundless. On the other hand, it is a historical and social phenomenon, an object of the study of history. The phenomenon of nihilism shows that our historical life has lost its ground as objective spirit, that the value system which supports this life has broken down, and that the entirety of social and historical life has loosened itself from its foundations. Nihilism is a sign of the collapse of the social order externally and of spiritual decay internally, and as such signifies a time of great upheaval. Viewed in this way, one might say that it is a general phenomenon that occurs from time to time in the course of history. And he was writing in post-war Japan, where they had an immense crisis. So I'd like just maybe to hear from you about how this translates, what I just read and what you wrote about in your book, in our current crises.
Yes, very, very good. And that's a very succinct analysis. Just so everyone knows, nihilism as a term comes from a Latin word nihil, which means nothing. And it's typically taken to be a philosophy or a way of life that says that there's no ultimate purpose or meaning, no fundamental standard to which we can appeal that enables us to distinguish between true and false, good and evil, even better or worse. And so it can be the result of deep social, political confusion, spiritual emptiness. Obviously, when it's taught, particularly to young people, either as a philosophy or through the stories we tell, it can have a coarsening and indeed corrosive effect on the moral imagination of young people. And that's in part what I was worried about in the book, looking at examples from television and film. And I do think that we are in a time where nihilism threatens us in lots of ways. I think even in our positive quest for justice, we've had a lot of talk since early summer after George Floyd about issues of racial injustice and mistreatment by the legal system, by police and by courts and so forth. And beneath that, in its deep authenticity is a great hunger for justice. But I think sometimes in our culture, when we talk about rights, when we talk about demands for justice, because we lack a consensus about what it means to be human, about what the foundations of justice are, whether they're in nature or in God, our discussions about these matters have an almost hysterical character to them that borders on the irrational and is always in danger of bordering on violence. Because we lack a sense of the foundation of purpose. And so we're always sort of threatened by nihilism, whether we're aware of it or not. The one last thing I'd say about this is the first part of that comment from the scholar you were reading is that the sense of one's own nothingness in religious traditions, I speak here especially in the Christian religious tradition, that insight into one's nothingness is a possibility of opening up into seeing one's very existence as a gift of the Creator God. And so in the deep religious traditions of which we are a part, that sense of nothingness is always part of our sense of ourselves, because we are not self-creators, because we are not fully autonomous, because we are not sufficient unto ourselves. And so that sense of my own nothingness within the ambit of a rich theology and liturgy and practice of a meaningful religious life, that is actually something that we are urged to have, right? We are urged to have a sense of our own nothingness, and that our dignity comes from our being created by God and from our subordinate relationship to God as creator and judge. And so when you have the experience of nothingness apart from that theological framework, the risk is always that everything falls apart, right? That then it's just bare meaninglessness.